Thank you. And now to the two who are joining us by video conference, I'd ask them to make some opening remarks. And we'll start with John Conroy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members of the Senate. I am billed as a lawyer, and I should perhaps just add that I, too, have been a criminal defense lawyer and for 45 years, consistent with Bill C-45. And, of course, in 1982, I became a constitutional lawyer once we got the charter. And throughout that whole period of time, I'm in Abbotsford, which is the Kingston of the West, surrounded by federal prisons, and have spent a considerable amount of time dealing with people in prison on this and other issues. I was called to the bar in 1972. That was the year of the cannabis report by the Ledain Commission, and I commend to you that especially all of those who say we're doing all of this in a hurry, go back and have a look at that and see what was discussed at that time, as well as all of the other royal commissions that have occurred going back to 1893. I was counsel in the Supreme Court of Canada on behalf of Mr. Kane in the Malmo Levine Kane challenge to prohibition that was decided in 2003. I was also counsel for Van Du in the supervised injection site case in the Supreme Court of Canada. And I was also counsel in Allard, the medical marijuana case that led to the finding of unconstitutionality of the marijuana for medical purposes regulations and led to the current access to cannabis for medical purposes regulations. I didn't realize that this panel was focused on home cultivation, so instead of going into the detail of the two prior defense lawyers whose submissions I would adopt, I'll turn and focus a bit on that, because there was extensive evidence in the Allard case on that very issue. The police and fire chiefs and so on brought old evidence from the days of when we had multiple grow ops in British Columbia here in particular, and there were problems of fire, mold, and public safety that arose in the illegal market. And once the government allowed people to grow for themselves or have somebody grow for them, first under the marijuana medical access regulations, and then tried to take it away under the marijuana for medical purposes regulations, we had people then legally growing cannabis. And this is very important because while there were all these problems during the illicit days, you would be hard-pressed to find a building inspector or a zoning inspector or people who are in government now at the local level who would want to go back to those old days, because we established quite clearly, and Justice Phelan found as a matter of fact, that all of the problems with home growing are, you can ameliorate them. You can take care of mold quite easily, and we had experts that testified. And so if you want to look at detailed evidence about mold, public safety, people have security cameras. They call the police if somebody tries to come. They give them the video, which they never did when they were also involved in the illegal market. And so the experience in terms of a transition from an illegal market or an illicit market or prohibition into a regulatory market occurred with the medical marijuana situation over the last 10 years and shows that legalization brings things up, shows what the problems are, enable people to take steps to ameliorate them and fix them. And so that's the most important thing that I think we have to realize. The Cannabis Act basically has a little bit of legalization in the beginning, the four plants. Thank goodness they got rid of the height restriction, which would have been really complicated. So the four plants and the 30 grams. And so that's the basic legalization, with the provinces being allowed to do the distribution. Then you've got a little bit of decriminalization that we used to talk about in the old days, and that's the ticketing scheme. If you're a bit over the limits in terms of the legalized part, you're into ticketing scheme, which is a civil type of a penalty. And then the rest of the act, as has been well described by the previous two speakers, is continued criminal law, and it's problematic. The Ledain report recommended a maximum of 5 years, 45 years ago, for indictable offenses. And we are still proposing, the Cannabis Act proposes 14. I can't remember if the prior speakers mentioned this, but it was under the conservative regime that the penalty for production was elevated from 7 years to 14. 14-year maximum is significant because back in 1972, Pierre Elliott Trudeau introduced absolute and conditional discharges to ameliorate the criminal record for possession of cannabis, and so that the records would be wiped out. You can't get an absolute or conditional discharge if there's a 14-year maximum. Similarly, many years later, the Sentencing Commission and others said we're incarcerating too many people, we need to decarcerate the nonviolent, and we created a sentencing option called the conditional sentence order. That, too, you can't get if the offense carries a maximum of 14 years and up. So if the parent growing the four plants who wants to talk to their young person, the 12 to 17-year-old, about cannabis and have a discussion so they don't go to the black market, they'll be committing an offense theoretically subject to a 14-year maximum. They won't be able to get a conditional sentence order. They will be facing potential imprisonment. So there are some really problematic things with that latter part of the bill, and I won't go into them in more detail because the prior two speakers did. So the most important thing I should also add, I incorporated NORML Canada back in 1977. I incorporated the BC Compassion Club Society in 1997, and so I've been around people involved in cannabis and various aspects of the situation for a long period of time, and I should add that I was also part of the ad hoc committee that sent to you, hopefully you've received it today, if not before, a response to the SAM submissions and documents that your committee received. And so you have that, or should have that, in detail, addressing the youth issues, the impaired driving issues, hospital visits, social justice charges and arrests, crime trends, and the opiate issue in some detail in that document, and I won't repeat it here. So the most important thing, I think, is for people who have still fears and worries about different things going to happen, is remember this is a beginning, it's a start, things can be changed over time, but most importantly, we're bringing the whole issue above ground instead of continuing to force it underground, not getting the statistics, not being able to do as much research as in the past, and bringing it up so that we can see exactly how it isn't going to be a significant problem, just as all the prior Royal Commissions and the Ledain Commission reported many years ago. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And Neil Boyd, Professor, Department of Criminology, Simon Fraser University.
Thanks very much for the opportunity.